Well, thank you everyone for joining us in Brisbane for the inaugural Hopper Down Under Conference. As you know, this is our very own version of AnitaB.org's famous Grace Hopper celebration. My name is Sue Kay, and as you probably know by now, I chaired the steering committee behind this event and have had the honour of being your MC over the last 2 days. It's customary in Australia to acknowledge the traditional custodians of these lands, and I'd like to respectfully acknowledge the First Nations people of the lands on which we gather today, Meamjin, Brisbane. And I recognise the country north and south of the Brisbane River as the home of both the Turrbal and Yugara nations. I pay my respect to their elders, past, present and emerging, and recognise that these lands have always been places of collaboration and learning. And I extend my respects to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people here with us today. So, unfortunately, we are nearing the end of what has been an amazing experience. Who's had a good time? Well, I'm going to recommend that you don't just soak in this moment, but you actually record it. So how about you jump up, quickly grab yourself a selfie, because you know, we never know how long it's going to be until you see this many women technologists in a room in Brisbane. Well, in Australia. Oh, here we go. Now make sure. Make sure you tweet this moment. Make sure you tweet this moment and use one of our hashtags, Hopper Down Under, or, oh, hang on, what was our other hashtag?
We are here.
Oh, thank goodness you remembered. You know, unfortunately, we weren't trending. We were knocked off the top perch by what three childhood books you've read lately, which I think is just wrong. So please get onto Twitter straight away. Make sure that we're trending up at number one again, because we were up there for 10 hours yesterday. How good is that? Well, we have a great lineup of closing keynote speakers this afternoon. And to start this session, I'd like to welcome Women in Tech Hall of Famer, Dr. Jali Dai. Jali is a multifaceted global thought leader with exceptional depth and breadth of experience in both private and public sectors. She's an investor, board director, and strategic advisor who has served the administrations of three presidents, served on many boards and worked in 8 countries. She's a sought-after speaker and media commentator. She is a partner at Aurora Equity and the founder and chair of Ag Food Tech, Band of Angels. Previously, she was the head of STEM at the David and Lucille Packard Foundation, managing a broad portfolio worth more than $120 million per year. Now, Jale started her career at Rutgers University and the University of Wisconsin-Madison, where she was a professor and the chief executive of a multidisciplinary unit and founded a university-wide graduate program, while also authoring over 100 scholarly papers. So she's been very busy. She's an LSQ ambassador, an honorary naval aviator, and has received a congressional citation, the Texia Lifetime Achievement Award, and an honorary doctorate. Please join with me to welcome to the stage Jali Dai.
Wow. I can't see most of you. Try. But thank you so much, Sue. For a wonderful introduction. I'm already emotional about this whole thing because I remember my young days. So I want to thank all the organizers, especially Sue and Jane and the wonderful Nosley, who facilitated my coming here, and also the institutions and corporations who supported the event, including CSIRO, Austrade, ANU, and a number of other Australian and American corporations here. So I do this quite often, and many times people want me to give statistics, you know, what percent of computer scientists or women, blah, 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 blah. You, the young generation, already know how to get information. So I thought, in the tradition, where is my gizmo? Here. How do I do this? Okay. All right, so first, I want to pay honor to two very remarkable women, Grace Hopper and Anita Borg. So let's do this together. Anita Borg and Grace Hopper. Thank you. All right, so, and I'm in Australia, where Aborigines used to own this land entirely. And at least from what I have read and heard, when they want to tell this story, they say sing a story. They don't say tell a story. I don't know if that's correct or not. But anyway, I thought today I would sing you my immigration and immigrant story, because Australia is very diverse, like the US, and many of you in this room are immigrant. So here we go. I have a daughter of Persia, and I was very, very untested. When I was young, I was naive and worldly. I was a real late bloomer, almost very foolish, and non-committed, totally non-committed to work and profession. I just didn't want to work, you know. Why, how could you blame an 18-year-old, right? But I came to U.S. because my dad wanted me to get a PhD. And boy, oh boy, the testing began. So I was tested. When I came here, I was a babe in the woods. Really, totally naive. But then the turbulence, the trauma, lots of tears, my own tenacity, and ultimately triumph. So this is what I want to sort of, in 26 minutes that I have left, do for you. All right. And so why was I crying so much? It was because I was faced with deportation without any cause. The simple cause of that was because, oh, I get emotional. Ooh. Because my passport was from a country that had taken hostages, American hostages, at their own embassy. So at that time, our president was Jimmy Carter, and I was not a citizen. I had much less right than a typical citizen. Gave an executive order that all Iranians will be deported. Those who had done something illegal or wrong would be deported immediately. People like me who were a student, I was a graduate student at that time. People like me who were students and had come with legal paperwork and all legitimate situation, we would be deported as our visa expires. And I was the luckiest one of all, my visa being expired next month. So, it was bad, and it was a forced metamorphosis for me, and traumatic, actually traumatic. It went on for 2 years, and I had to continue doing my research, keep my focus on working, and see what happens. So, going through 2 years of trauma, what happened to me was actually very new and strange to me myself. I developed what I call the immigrant syndrome, a very strong case of it. which is this drive, deep drive, to prove that I was worthy of staying in the U.S. Like, I wanted to prove to them that, hey, I'm just as good as you are, maybe better than some of you. So that really just bubbled into me. I don't know from where. It just came. And I developed this peculiar ambition to earn the respect of the decision makers, because it was the ultimate decision maker, the President of the United States, that gave me the deportation orders, right? So, and through this 2 years, something developed in my head. It was something like this. I want to be in the room where it happens. And I stole this line after going to Hamilton. I knew a version of it, but I just said, oh, this is what was singing in my head all these years. I don't know how many of you have you seen. How many has seen Hamilton? I understand it's running in Brisbane right now, isn't it? So if you get a chance to see it, please go see it. This is what Richard Burr, who was the sort of rival with Hamilton, was looking at Hamilton, what he was doing, and he couldn't be as good as he was. But this is what he was saying. I want to be in the room where it happens, because Hamilton was in the room that it was happening. So that became my mental mantra. All right, so now let's move on, get into zigzagging my profession, through my profession to the top. It wasn't a straight line. In my case, it's been very, very zigzaggy. And I think, look at my grades after all these years, I now realize actually a better path is zigzaggy. So don't be afraid of zigzagging. All right, so I worked, as Sue mentioned, I worked in private and public sectors in almost all of the different economic segments. Started in academia when I was a fresh PhD. My first job was joining a university, research university. And I, because of that immigrant syndrome, it has stayed with me to this day. I have the immigrant syndrome. I can't cure it anymore. So I worked so hard that I turned out to be a fast track. Thank you. I wasn't smarter than anybody else. I just had immigrant syndrome, and I busted my tail. In 6 years, I made rank of full professor. It usually takes 12 years in the U.S. So once I had reached the top of the academic ranks, I then said, okay, I now need to do national and international things. So I developed a national presence. So as I go, the reason I put these lines on there so you can take pictures is because I want you to think about these things in very serious ways. You need to have national, first, in your corporation, organization visibility, second, national, and third, global. So have some thought process about how you want to do that. So the way I started by having a national presence, it wasn't just because I was doing good research, I would go present papers, but I stood for election for professional organizations. I became president of the American Association for Women in Science in Washington, D.C., national organization. I was chairman of a Council of Scientific Society president. So when somebody came and asked me, I think you should do this, despite the fact that I had 1,600 balls in the air, I said, yes, I'll do it. So please, take pieces of what I'm saying with you. Each one of you can take a separate piece. And then the other way that I wanted to develop international visibility was to go on sabbaticals, collaborate with with researchers. It's not just because I wanted to have national, international visibility for the sake of international visibility. These were some of the best scientists in the world, and I thought by doing work in their labs, I would learn a lot, I would make friends everywhere, and I will become more visible. All right, that was number one career, academia, 20 years. But while I was there, I was doing all these other things, the sabbaticals. I took a sabbatical in Washington, D.C. I worked on policy and politics, and that was the pivotal moment in my career, because it was an eye-opener. I had been brainwashed, like all the other PhDs in the US, and I suppose in Austria too, that the only way that I can pay my advisors, teachers, was to walk in their footsteps and be a research professor. And I had done that because I was brainwashed. So when I went to Washington, D.C., I realized, oh my God, there is a big, beautiful world out there. The emperor can have clothes outside academia. So that was it. I came back, and at the same time, I was doing president or chairman of these NGOs. So I came back from that sabbatical, and I said, okay, I'm gonna quietly find my way out of academia. You don't abruptly pack and go. You just have to find another job, right? So I told my friends and colleagues that if you see something out there that my qualifications would fit, please keep me in mind. Just let me know. I'll apply. So lo and behold, the David and Lucille Packard Foundation was recruiting a new director for science and technology. This is what David Packard himself was doing at the foundation, but he was frail and near end of his life. And so he told the children that we are going to go outside and hire a professional. So I was the lucky one. They had a national search. I got it, went there. So career number four ended in a bust. So the second trauma in my life. So I've given up my tenure and everything from the university, and I'm joining a private foundation that could fire you any day. I figured I'm good enough. If they fire me, I'll go find something else, right? You know, in a half-hearted way, I said that to myself. Not in a serious way. I never thought anybody would fire me. I'm so good, I thought. I was arrogant. But this is, God has plans for you. It's like, God has plans for me to go through storms and trauma. So what happened? I go there in sort of 98, 99. 2 years after I'm there, the dot-com bubble happened. Too many of you are young. You don't remember the crash of 2000, do you? How many remembered the crash, the tech crash of 2000? Okay, all right. So, great. At least half of you know about it. So the stock market dropped 50% in a course of 4, 5, 6 months. And at the time that I was there, we were the biggest foundation in the world, $20+ billion endowment. Ain't that bad, huh? So after the crash, most of our endowment, because most of our endowment was in Hewlett-Packard stocks, we were decimated. $4.5 billion. We went to $4.5 billion in 6 months or so. So there was no money to give. I had no job, you know. So anyway, that was the end of that career number five. Or was it four? Four. So, and I'll tell you a secret. How I handle this one. I cried me a river every night. It's like a stupid woman. You give up your tenure without a plan B? But then in my head, some voice was saying to me, I mean, that's instinct. That's female instinct. I didn't have any mentors to tell me this. But the female instinct, the woman instinct in my head was saying, woman, don't make this more than 3-4 months. Enough crying and enough moping around. You go find something, do something new. So the useful thing in my head that ran day and night was, don't make it be more than 6 months. And because of that, I summoned enough energy to go think about what I want to do next and actually go do something about it. And that's how I ended up being in Silicon Valley. What do you do more often than anything else? Is venture capitalist. And that time, my husband is still a venture capitalist. He was a venture capitalist, and I said, I can do that, probably better than he does. But I didn't want to work in his company because I don't believe in that sort of thing. Women always stay under the shadow, no matter what. So I sort of find a way to not work in his company and do my own investment. All right, so I'm pivoting now. Get ready. So 5 careers so far. Does anybody want to hire me for my 6th?
Yes.
Okay, I'm game. Thank you. So there is life still for me. All right, so 5 careers. And you say, this woman is crazy. And you're right, I'm crazy. But I loved everything I did, including losing that beautiful, fantastic job at the Packard Foundation. There is no regret, not an ounce of regret in my life. Some people would say, don't you regret having given up 10 years? I said, are you kidding me? You know, 10 years. I'm against 10 years, by the way. Those of you who are at the universities, I don't think it's a very good system. Even though I got it very early, I have nothing against it. Okay, so I'm pivoting to the core message that I want you to take home with you. If there's one thing I want you to leave this room with is resilience, because that was the saving grace in my life, in my career. So I want you to read with me, please. Can you read with me? Resilience, strength, plus endurance. Ineffable quality that allows some people knocked down by life to come back at least as strong as before. Sometimes even stronger. Bravo! You said it! Bravo! And I would tell you this, it can be learned. If you think you don't know, when I went through those traumas, I had no clue I had resilience. So it's in you. I guarantee you it's in you, but it also can be learned by preparing yourself for severe events in your life. You can develop, read about it, think about it, learn about it. Okay, one other subject. I have only 25 minutes. I have to go through a lot. So, of glass and class ceiling. So you say, well, she's American. Well, what is she talking about, class? We don't have caste system in America. You're right, we don't. But we do. I'll tell you how and where. So, and I would also tell you this, that it's a heck of a lot easier to break the glass ceiling than the class ceiling. Many times during my career, which was a very, you know, some people think charming, I felt like I was a Ferrari engine in a VW frame. That was the sort of, they put you in a class, even if you're a Ferrari engine, if you don't have a degree from Stanford, Harvard, or MIT, you're the VW frame. So that's how I felt. I went to public schools, you know, UC Davis. Who knows about UC Davis? Yeah, thank you. Just go for it, do it. All right, so the class system in the US, we don't call it class, we call it elites. I bet you know about it here too. Why do you think people want to get an elite education or be part of the elite networks? You have probably read the scandals in the US, parents bribing to get their kids in elite schools. That's how important it is. That's the class belonging to the right elite groups. Well, of course, I didn't have it, but I worked at it. Now I am in powerful elite networks without an elite education. So it's even better, right? Okay. So some of you may want to know, is the elite education more important or resilience? Who thinks number one is more important? Please raise your hand. Who thinks resilience is more important? Woo! We are on the same page. All right. Number one is a nice thing to have from my perspective. Number two is a must have. I think if you want to have a staying power in your career, you must have resilience, because I don't know anybody who hasn't gone through some severe event in their life. To stand up on your feet, you need to have resilience. All right. See, I'm pivoting very quickly every time because I need to cover a lot of grounds. My mistakes and what I learned from them. The price was a lot of gray and a lot of fat on my body. So, importance of elite education versus networks. I didn't know this for the first 15, 20 years of my career. I didn't realize it. It was later on that I was made to feel like a Ferrari engine in a VW frame. That's how I found out that is so important in your career. So because I have already not had the education, I sort of said to myself, okay, from now on, I will do my best in order to be accepted in the elite networks. That was my only recourse. So that's what I have done things, you know, to make sure that I have influential groups working with me. Risk-taking without a plan B. I mentioned it already. Giving up my tenure and everything to go work for a private corporation. Not that I regret it, but I want you to think about something like this. Always have a plan B. I had zero plan B. I thought I would retire at Packard Foundation. Seriously, not to be. I also, and this is a cultural thing, I also was big, big time in avoiding confrontation. I would be at meetings with a bunch of other, mostly male, because I was the first this, the first that. I would be there and I would say, let's do this, let's, you know, the research should go in this direction, blah, blah. And somebody would pick it up, take my idea and run with it. And I didn't have the gumption to go get up and say, look, thank you so much for taking my idea. So learn not to confront, to be confrontational, but stand up. Now, if somebody, the people still steal my ideas, don't get me wrong. It's not like they are scared anymore. No, they do. But I very politely, with a big fake smile, say, thank you so much for agreeing with me. This is exactly what I just said 5 minutes ago. So stand up and made it known that it's your idea. And say, I would love to have you come work with me. And then the other thing, cultural again. You may not have that issue. But I showed an awful lot of one-sided loyalty. What was the word that we learned yesterday, Nasli? inherently. I'm inherently a giver. So that's the way I was raised. That's my constitution. A lot of people took much too much from me, and I didn't do much about it until I felt really icky. Okay, I'm going to go back. No, it's already there. All right, so I talked about women. I honored our founding mothers and sisters. But I do want to say something about men. Because I was of a generation that was the trailblazer, first woman this, first woman that, I didn't see any women. I didn't have mentors. I didn't have women role models. My role models were men. I would look around and say, ah, he is so good. I want to be like him when I grow up. So I would tell you of a dozen men, maybe even less, eight, I would say, men who have been influential in my life, four of them are Aussies. Woo! Who would have thunk? So, Aussies, in order of meeting them, there is no priority here. It's just the date I met them. I first met John Patrick, professor at Newcastle University. We worked on research projects together. The second one, Jim Peacock of CSIRO, and he was the first chief scientist of Australia. I did my sabbatical in his lab. He insisted I go to his lab. He paid my way to go to his lab, so I love him dearly. And Sagadavan, Professor Sagadavan Mundry at QUT. I knew him before he was an Aussie. I met him in South Africa. And now he's a very influential QUT professor and internationally renowned. And of course, last but not least, Mario Panisi. He was at that time CEO of Lab Sciences Queensland, LSQ. And he's been very, very helpful and influential in my life as well. So, baby, keep walking and keep remembering. And that mantra I gave you, hold on to it. I want to be in the room where it happens. Bravo, thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Charlie. We are fortunate to be able to welcome one of Australia's only Abbey Award winners to the stage today, Professor Genevieve Bell. The Abbey Awards are announced at the Grace Hopper Celebration and recognise exceptional women technologists. In 2013, Genevieve received the Women of Vision Abbey Award for Leadership, for fundamentally altering the way that Intel envisages and plans its products so that they are centred on people's needs rather than simply silicon capabilities. Genevieve is the director of the 3A Institute, the Florence Violet McKenzie Chair and Distinguished Professor at the Australian National University, and a Vice President and Senior Fellow at Intel. She is a cultural anthropologist, best known for her work at the intersection of cultural practice and technology development. Genevieve currently heads the 3A Institute, co-founded by the ANU and CSIRO's Data 61, tasked with building a new applied science around the management of artificial intelligence, data technology, and their impact on humanity. She presented the highly acclaimed ABC Boyer Lectures for 2017, in which she investigated what it means to be human and Australian in a digital world. In 2018, Genevieve was appointed as a non-executive director of the Commonwealth Bank of Australia Board. She became a member of the Prime Minister's National Science and Technology Council and a fellow of the Australian Academy of Technology and Engineering. Genevieve will challenge us with her keynote on managing electricity, telling stories of women, technology, and monsters. Please join me to welcome Professor Genevieve Bell.
So I did the thing you get to do when you're at the end of 2 days, which is change the title of my talk and thus change the entire talk underneath of it. And here's the deal. I figured I'd call my talk after a hashtag because that way it would stay trending. So, talk is called We Are Here. Exactly. Photograph, tweet, go. Instagram, also TikTok, I am not platform bossy. Just pick one and put it out there. So listen, it's my incredible privilege to be here, to be in Brisbane, to be in Australia, to be at an event honoring Grace Hopper and everyone else. It's also always my pleasure to be in my home country, on Aboriginal country. And like everyone else who stood on this stage, I want to acknowledge that we meet on country that has been continuously occupied for at least 80,000 years and occupied by people who built everything. They built a world, they built a social system, they built technologies, they built ways to manage this place and to manage it remarkably over a protracted period of time. And every time any one of us stands on a stage as Australians here or abroad, we carry with us a privilege and a responsibility because of that history. And it's not just a history. It's the legacy of this place. It should run through all of our bones, and it should be the story we always tell. And it's a story about knowing the names, about knowing the places, and knowing the history. And that's the story I wanted to tell, and I wanted to start with this map, which doesn't look like a map. I'm not going to ask you if any of you recognize it, because I know there's one person in the room who does, and I'm going to punish her for it later. This is a map of computer science. This is actually a map of software. This is a map of languages for managing software. And if you look to the far left of that diagram, right in the middle center, there's a node on the far edge. That's Fortran and a man named Barkas in 1954. Go up and slightly in to that second orange dot with the ellipse on top of it. That's Grace. That's Grace Hopper right there in 1956, writing a language called Flowmatic, which became COBOL, which changed the way we think about computers, which is why in some way all of us are in this room one way or another, right? And the lovely thing about getting to be here is we get to hear Grace's name over and over again. But I also figured there's a whole lot of other names we probably should hear over and over again. And what I wanted to do was tell you some of their stories. Because like everyone else who stood on this stage, I actually think that stories are the most important thing. They carry our cultural DNA. They carry our legacies. And for every single one of you in this room, they are also your history and your lineage as much as being Australian or of a particular place is. So you have to start with Grace. How many of you had heard of Grace Hopper before you registered for the Hopper event? It's not bad, but it should be more hands. That's Grace towards the end of her life. If you could pull the picture back a little bit, you'd see there was a pirate flag hanging over her desk. Kind of interesting for a woman who insisted on being called Admiral Grace Hopper until she died at 90, long after the Navy had suggested she should no longer be allowed to wear the uniform or be called Admiral. Grace was small and very bolshy, and you really didn't resist her terribly often. And she used to say she went through the world as an admiral, but she'd go out of the world as a pirate. Exactly, kind of aspirational, right? Because she knew something in particular. She knew that every time she stood up, she was the keeper of a very particular set of histories. Grace was one of the very first women to program one of the very first computers. She programmed the Harvard Mark I back in the 1940s and early 1950s. It was on the basis of that that the Rand Corporation and General Electric tapped her to come and help build a programming language for their new computers. And she wrote that programming language, COBOL, in the early 1950s. But she didn't stop there. She was only in her 40s at that point. Grace went on for the rest of her life to do a couple of things. One was everywhere she went, she had a handbag, a bit like the Queen, but a slightly more interesting handbag, I have to say. Because lurking inside that handbag was a foot of cable. I know exactly, it's like, yeah, you could have money, you could have a foot of cable. Grace had a foot of cable, and every time she produced it, she used to explain to people about how long it took from data to get from one end of that cable to the other end of that cable. Because the thing she knew was every time she stood somewhere in her uniform and in her history, that she had an opportunity to tell a story. And that story should always count, and that she should never miss the opportunity to make it matter. And so she had that prop, secretly, I think, because Grace might have been a little bit shy, and she needed something to make that conversation work. So she was always a storyteller. She was always a teacher, and she always knew that who she was meant that every time people saw her, they needed her to be more than just Grace. They needed her to be Admiral Grace Hopper, going through life an admiral, going out of life a pirate. I'd like to imagine that Grace wasn't lonely, but I bet she was. And many years later, Telly Whitney and Anita Borg in 1994 going into 1995, so 25 years ago, computer scientists in Silicon Valley, I was lucky enough to know them both, sat down and said, you know, the only time we ever see other women in the valley is in the women's room, like when we go to the toilet. It's the only time we see other women because they're never anywhere else. We only ever see them when we're at conferences and then there's only a few. I always like going to Grace Hopper because I have to queue for a bathroom. Perversely, that is a sign of progress. But Telly and Anita thought, well, we don't want to be the only ones. We don't want to think we're the only ones. We don't want to imagine that the women are all somewhere else. So maybe we need to get them all in one place together once a year so they can all see each other and know they're not alone. And they decided to name it after Grace because, of course, they both knew Grace. Hard not to know Grace if you're a computer scientist and a woman in Silicon Valley in the 1980s and 1990s, because she's the only name anyone remembered. We know others now, but in those days it was Grace. And so part of Anita, sadly now no longer with us, and Telly's gift to all of us was two things. One, to give us back Grace's name, and the other, to give us a place where we get to know all of each other's. So I reckon back when Grace was a young woman, there were some other names that maybe she knew. And I thought maybe we should remember them too. Some of them you know. Guess the surname. Exactly. Marie Curie. And I bet like you and me, you're like, oh God, like another talk about women and we start with Marie Curie. God, aren't there any others? Yep, I know you think that. So here's the thing. Let me tell you the Marie Curie story you don't know. Yeah, Marie Curie was a physicist. She was the first woman to win a Nobel Prize. She was the first woman and first person to win two. She was amazing. She was a physicist. She discovered radium. She changed the face of physics theoretically and practically. She was extraordinary. And truthfully, that could have been enough. But here's the thing. Curie wasn't just the first woman to win a Nobel Prize. She was also an engineer. Because in 1914, World War I happened, and she was living in France. And she could have chosen to stay inside her lab at the Sorbonne, although, unsurprisingly, they wouldn't let her have a lab in the regular building. They put her out back in a shed. She sucked that one up because Marie was good that way. She could have chosen to stay in her slightly inadequate office space, but she chose to do something else instead because she realized that her technical work, her work with radium, meant that she knew more about X-ray technology than almost anyone else in the world. And she was increasingly certain that X-ray technology was going to be critically important in battlefield medicine. And so in 1914 and into 1915, Marie bought a Renault truck and a manual and took it apart. She hacked it. She worked out how it ran. She worked out what it took to run it. She worked out the weight and the affordances. And then she worked out how to put an X-ray machine in it and run it off its truck battery. And she created a mobile X-ray van. And she drove it to the front line. And she X-rayed soldiers. And over the space of the next 3 years in the war, she built 20 more. And over the space of all of World War I, 1 million soldiers were treated in these vehicles. She drove them, her daughter drove them, she convinced other people in Paris to drive them. They're called the Petite Curies, the Little Curies. And if there's a reason we should remember Marie Curie, it's actually this. Because it wasn't just about knowledge, it was about making that knowledge practical. It was about being the quintessential moment of being an engineer. It was about seeing a problem and solving it. And it was about someone who didn't have to do that. She really didn't have anything left to prove. But she couldn't imagine a world in which she wasn't doing something that mattered. So maybe we should know Marie Curie's name, right? And then maybe we should know this name. Loie Fuller. When you go home, you will Google Loie Fuller. You will not do it right now. Because you will need to go to YouTube to Google Loie Fuller. because that's where you will find her best. Louie Fuller was an American. She was a dancer, she was a performer, and she was, in fact, a chemical engineer with patents. Because what Louie wanted to do in Paris at the same time Mari was shoveling pitch blend behind the Sorbonne, Louie was on the stage in Paris with a light show called the Serpentine Dance. See that dress? It's entirely made of silk. What you can't tell, because we didn't really have particularly good color photos when this dance was done, was that she had taken all the early electricity that was available in Paris, put it into her stage show, and worked out how to make chemical filters to make the light change colors in real time. She was a dancer with patents. She was a performer with an idea about the technology. She was someone who imagined that technology shouldn't just be about solving pragmatic problems, it should be about telling stories, about making things that were beautiful, but also about understanding what you were working with to make it happen. Michaela Jade, wherever you are in the room, that one's for you. And then there's Lillian. Bet you don't know her name either. But close your eyes and think about the kitchen you grew up in or the kitchen you still own. Stand in the middle of that kitchen and imagine going to the fridge. Open the fridge door, and on the door, above the milk, which is probably rancid because you've been gone for a while, you will find two compartments, right? One with a little door for the butter, and one, if your fridge is old enough, with the plastic indentations for the eggs. We have those because of Lillian Gilbraith. Lillian Gilbraith was actually also one of the very first women to get a degree in engineering in the United States. She actually has two degrees in engineering, one from Berkeley and one from Brown. Don't ask why she had two PhDs. It's complicated. It involves a husband, 12 children, and residency requirements. because that's what all good stories should involve, is to having two PhDs. But by the time she got her second, Lillian became an expert in, well, as one of her contemporaries put it, she was the genius in the art of living. Lillian worked out that it was really hard to be a woman engineer in a big tech company solving technical problems. And so she took everything she knew and turned her technical lens onto the kitchen. She, over the period between World War I and World War II, interviewed 4,000 people about what they did in their kitchens. And every single one of you lives her findings every day. It's called the efficiency triangle. It's the triangle that means your fridge, your sink, and your stove are not all lined up on one wall, but are in a triangle so that you can expend energy in a rational manner. She's the reason you have a garbage bin with a pedal and a lid that comes up. She's the reason that the eggs don't fall out of the fridge door and that the butter stays at a different temperature than everything else in the fridge. She's the reason some of you might have dishwashers and possibly food processors. Because she took everything she knew and she worked out how to make it into a space where she could be successful. She's also got a tremendous number of patents. Oh yeah, and by the way, 12 children. And here's the thing about Lillian. She had 12 children with her husband, John. He conveniently died when the youngest child was 2. Yeah, exactly. And so Lillian then worked out how to run the company without John. For a while, she just claimed he was late. And went on to take some of her best, I don't know how long that gig would last, but think pre-internet. Think specifically 1924, when you could claim your husband was late for several years before anyone would really ask. But she made the whole world we live in now. She shaped everything in one whole room of your house, and I bet you don't know her name. But you should. And after Lillian, there's Florence. Sue said, I held the Florence Violet McKenzie chair. This is the Florence of Florence Violet McKenzie. Florence is the first woman electrical engineer in Australia. She was the first woman to be qualified as an electrical engineer. She ran the first business as a woman electrical engineer. She started the first radio shop run by a woman in Australia, favored by hobbyists up and down the East Coast. Between the wars and through World War II, she trained at least 12,000 Australian servicemen in how to use Morse code and signals. And oh, by the way, when she was done with all of that, she wrote a cookbook called the All Electric Cookbook. in which she taught Australian women how to cook with electricity. Because Florence was a bit all singing, all dancing, triple threat. She was an entrepreneur, she was an academic, she had a government kind of hat on, and she did everything. And she was eccentric in a delightful manner. She kept outdoor tropical fish in Sydney, which I think was an excuse to display her electrical prowess, but I've never entirely worked that out. And she founded an organization called the Electrical Association for Women in 1934, which was a group of women in Australia who helped advocate for domestic electricity. The reason that fridge in your house even lights up, let alone has an egg compartment, is because of Florence. She helped ensure that every Australian home had electricity and that all of us knew how to use it. She published a manual for Australian women to work out how to troubleshoot their own electrical systems. It had cross sections of every appliance in your home. It had instructions for rewiring things. It had instructions for how to read a meter and how to negotiate rates. It also has a discourse about tariffs that is surprisingly pertinent in 2019. And last but by no means least, there's Margaret Mead. So why is she in this list, right? Because Margaret Mead's an anthropologist like me. Margaret Mead was a social change agent. Margaret Mead was a social commentator. She was the woman who coined the phrase the generation gap. She was the first person to ever publish anything welcoming about homosexuality in the mainstream American press. She wrote an article for Good Housekeeping in the 1960s suggesting that homosexuality was just part of the broad spectrum of human sexuality and people should stop being quite so worried. Took a long time for Margaret to be right about that. And she has many other claims to fame, but the reason she's relevant to all of us is that between 1946 and 1954, she co-hosted a series of conferences in New York City with a man named Norbert Wiener and another man named John von Neumann, the men who built computing and cybernetics. And they hosted a series of conferences over 8 years that litigated what it would mean to think about a world where technology, ecology, and humans came together in one piece. They called that world cybernetics. Margaret's job was to make sure that the participants in that conversation were not the same people again and again and again. She made sure that that conference had people from all over the world. She made sure that represented at that conference in New York City were people from Mexico and Japan and Europe and elsewhere in Latin America. She made sure there were women there. She made sure that the future of computers weren't being discussed only by computer scientists and mathematicians. She made sure there were anthropologists and psychologists and biologists in the room, because she believed the only way you change the world was by having all those voices in the room. And she was acutely aware that if you wanted to have all those voices in the room, not only did it make a cacophony, but you had to learn to listen just a little bit differently. So Grace, Mari, Loie, Lillian, Florence, Margaret, lots of names, right? Guess what? That's our history, but here's the other thing. We are now in a room full of people, and it's not so much for me we are here, it's that we're everywhere. And here's the thing, your responsibility from me, I have three asks. Here's the first ask. In this room, I guarantee you, there are women and a few men worthy. Not like that. Worthy of Grace Hopper and of Anita and of Telly and of Margaret and Loie and Lillian and a whole lot of other names I don't have time to recite, but I would love to. Sitting in this room, there are women whose names you should already know. The women who organized this event, the woman who stood on this stage, the women in this room that are my friends and my colleagues and my co-conspirators. And I hope for all of you, there's a whole lot of women you've met over the last 2 days that will be that for you. That would be what Grace wanted. It would certainly be what Telly and Anita would want. I know it's what the organizers would want. And what that means is you need to meet some people here you didn't meet before you got here. You've had 2 days, so you should already have done this. This shouldn't be a big ask on my part. And you need to go home and say those names over and over again, like an incantation and a chant. Because the notion that we are here is great, but we actually need to know who we are, right? And where we came from and who our history is and who our future is and who we need to look to when we need to get things done. Because what this is not just a celebration of Grace Hopper and women in science and technology. It's an opportunity to build a world we all want to live in And that world can't look like the world we live in now. And it certainly can't look like the world we once lived in. Because I can tell you all those stories about remarkable women, but what do you notice about them? They're mostly white. They're remarkably American and European. I have to struggle to find an Australian there. I could have added Barbara Johnson's name and had an African-American scientist, but I shouldn't have to work that hard. And in this room are all the women that should fill that gap, are all the women that will be the women of color, the women of Persia, and of Asia, and of Africa, and of this continent. And if we want to make a world that is a world where we are everywhere, that actually means we all have not just the privilege of being here, but the responsibility of being here too. And that responsibility means you get to enjoy the moment, but you have to make sure it carries forward. It can't just be this. It has to be what this means outside of this room too, and all the connections it makes, and all the names you need to remember and keep saying. So that was ask number one. Ask number two, slightly more straightforward. I've come home to Australia. I'm doing one thing and one thing only. I am building a new applied science to take artificial intelligence safely to scale. I really am. And whenever I say that, people think I'm insane. Because when was the last time someone stood up and said, I thought I'd build a new branch of engineering or possibly new applied science and I need to get it done by 2021? I spent 20 years in Silicon Valley. I know exactly what I'm saying when I say that. I also spent 20 years in Silicon Valley, so I know one other thing, which is no one does something that insane by themselves. And no matter whatever story you ever heard about how Silicon Valley was made, all those stories about lone men and the Joseph Campbell hero's journey, they're all lies. Every single one of those men had other people with them. And I know better than to think I want to do it alone or that I can do it alone. So my second request, I need help. You're going to build a new applied science, you do not want to do it alone. If you're going to build a new graduate program out of nowhere with the following deficits, the discipline has no name, the program has a name no one understands, and I have to make you move to Canberra. Don't go, you don't mean that. You really don't. I know you don't. So in order to get people to do that, I need help. And here is the help I would like today. There is a URL on that photo. Please take a picture of that photo. Please post it to the internet. You will do Sue a favor by putting the hashtag #HopperDownUnder on it. You will do me a favor by sending it out on your networks. Because last year, at this same moment in time, I stood on stages across Australia and the world and I said, I have this program and I don't really know what it's going to be called and I need help. And in 5 weeks, we got 173 applicants to a program that had no name in a discipline that didn't exist yet in Canberra. 50% of those applicants were female. Not bad. Exactly. As it turns out, I'd like to do better this year because competitive with myself. So we got 173 applicants last year. I'd like to double that. And to make that happen, I need help. So one more time with feeling. Take a picture of the slide. Send, or the photo, take a picture of that image. Take a picture of my sad, slightly guilty robot. And please, send it to your friends. Send them the link. Encourage them to apply. Please apply yourselves. Michaela, I'm looking at you, wherever you have gone. Please apply yourselves. I would like people who want to build something new. It's always my commitment, right? I want the world to be a different place than I find it. I want it to be a better place than I find it. And I don't want it for me alone. I want it for everyone. And in order to make that happen, I need help. So get me graduate students. And then eventually those will become PhD students. And then they will go out into the world and change everything because I'm not a big believer in keeping people in universities. I'm a big believer in releasing them back into the world and letting them make their way there as someone who did that myself. And then I have one last ask. And 39 seconds on the clock, and I bet she thought she was going to get out from underneath of this. So I said at the beginning that there was one person in the room who would recognize the image on that first slide. That is my frequent, that's the one, thank you very much. I love that. Well done. That image, there. So there's one person in the room who would recognize it. She is my frequent code troublemaker. She is my dear friend, and unfortunately for her at this particular moment in time, my boss. She's Eleanor Huntington. Some of you heard her yesterday talking about quantum computing. And here's what I need with 3 seconds on the clock. It's her birthday today. And I feel, as a result, two things must now happen. Maybe three. I'm not going to make the dean stand up, but let's be clear, Crichton Nichols is standing right next to her. If I make him stand up, you can see him a mile away. Crichton, there we go, right. A visual joke I didn't plan. All right, so number one, the dean is now standing up. Number two, we're going to sing a happy birthday. Number three, anyone who is live connected to the internet is going to stream it because there are people in Canberra who feel bad they can't be here. And I'm not going to sing. Go, thank you. Go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Eleanor. Happy birthday to you.
Woo! Because here's the last thing I know. You have to remember the names. You have to pick yourself up every time it doesn't go the way you want. But if you don't know how to celebrate the victories and the wins, there's no point. So, celebrate each other, celebrate the wins, keep saying Grace's name over and over again because I know it would make her happy. Go in an admiral and out a pirate. Thank you.
Thank you, Genevieve. My birthday is 25th of August. Just putting it out there. And thank you also for sharing so many stories that show that we are here. And, you know, clearly we have been here for some time and we now all have a responsibility to be here in the future and to take advantage of the opportunities that this conference presents in the future. I'm sure we're back trending now. And now with our closing keynote, I'd like to welcome back to the stage Dr. Jackie Copeland, the Chief Operating Officer of AnitaBee.org, the non-profit social enterprise behind the Gracehopper celebration, and the enterprise that we all in this room owe a huge debt of gratitude for investing AnitaBee.org resources into building an AnitaBee.org community in our region. Welcome and thank you for having faith in us. Please welcome to the stage Dr. Jackie Copeland.
All right, so is this a good time or what? I want to start today, and I know the convention is to end with a thank you, but I can't imagine talking or closing this out without thanking you. We have created today, the past 2 days, history. The first ever Gracehopper-inspired event in Australia. I want to thank my fellow troublemaker anthropologist, Genevieve, who is really an icon in our field. It's wonderful to be here with her. It's wonderful to be here with all of you. I want to specifically thank all of the organizers. They burnt midnight oil on Australian time to make this happen. I want to thank all of the other volunteers. As I name your group, would you please stand up and let's start giving ourselves a standing O because we totally deserve it. Okay, organizers, beginning with Sue and Sally Ann. My amazing team. Every last one of you, stand up. Accept your honor. All of our sponsors. And everyone else here and online, stand up. Women need to learn to appreciate and celebrate ourselves. We also thank our allies, male, non-binary, everyone who has supported us. We are here and we're not going anywhere, so get used to it. So I also wanted to share what I think are some key lessons that or experiences that we have had here together that we can build on. Clearly, we have looked back to move forward. We have paid homage to our ancestors, the original owners of this land, and frankly, the continent's first innovators, tech innovators who created fire stick farming, still used in Australia today to sustain our land. Knowledge systems that span eons and are embedded in the very fabric of Australia and the world. We networked to build community, and community is the first platform for true change. We learned and created new knowledge together. But although we're ending our first ever Hopper Down Under, this is a new beginning. And I want to talk a little bit about what's beyond Hopper Down Under, this wonderful celebration. First thing we need to do is get involved. And there are many ways to do that, and I want to highlight a few that are low-hanging fruit that you can do before you leave this event. First of all, join our community. We, as a result of your collective effort, are creating our first Australian, New Zealand, AnitaB.org community. And that's important because that is the grassroots. That is the basis of the change we want to see. So there is the web address. Join the community. We will be having a viewing party for Grace Hopper Celebration 2019, streamed from Orlando. And there are actually millions of women participating in that event online. So participate in the Australian viewing parties, which are being held in multiple cities. We have one of our many wonderful team members here, Natasha Green, who is our global community manager. You can find her. You can also email her to find out more information. I want to say, too, and this is kind of where Anita B is right now, it's great to be a social enterprise. It is wonderful to have these outstanding celebrations, but we are in the business of social change. And the reason women have made some progress, took two steps forward, but at least one step backwards, is that it's not enough to be an enterprise. It's not enough to have great celebrations. So I want you to leave here today and start devising a plan for action. I want you to think specifically about what you can do in your family, because social change starts at the level of our friendships and our family relationships. In your community, in your place of work, in your voluntary associations, I want you to think about how you can specifically promote representation of women, all women, pay parity, retention, and venture funding. Those are the core foundations of accelerating change in the tech space so that we can achieve 50-50 equity for all tech women in 5 years. And we're totally serious about it. We can't do it without you, but if we're all working every day towards that direction, we will be there in 2025. I want you to think about, well, learn about, and then get involved in some initiatives. We are deepening and scaling our programming so that we can help contribute to this ripple effect of change. We have a membership pilot. We have an improved corporate partnership service where we're actually helping companies with their D&I issues, particularly as it relates to women. We have a global policy reform and educational initiative that's working with universities and government leaders to remove policy barriers really to the full attainment of women's potential and rights. We have measurement tools. We have an initiative that we call Top Companies that helps companies look deep into their D&I issues and measure progress. And we have an awards program recognizing those companies who are doing the best in addressing their diversity and inclusion issues. We have expanded our annual survey of women and men in technology to be global and have more of a focus on equity. And it is called Techies. It is the Tech Equity Survey. You will be receiving it by virtue of being here. And we are a powerful force for change and good. 25,000 tech women and allies will be in Orlando alone. If we add the voice of all of the women we've worked with globally, we will really become a voice for change to hold this field accountable for our inclusion and our success. So participate. And there is the contact information for a woman who works with me who can refer you to the various leaders who are running these initiatives. So I want to end with some thoughts that may be a little controversial. Okay, but I wouldn't be myself if I didn't do that. So we often hear that there is a special impact, a kind of leadership that women bring to whatever spaces we work in. That women, the research shows that women try to be more fair, they're focused on quality and collaboration, and all of those leadership skills that we say are essential in a 21st century global economy. But I will tell you something that I have seen in my 15 years now in Silicon Valley. Sometimes we are so traumatized by bro culture that we become bros in skirts. How many women have had that experience of thinking that they were going to work for a woman and it would be nirvana and there would be no issues, et cetera, and that women had a critical mass in an organization you were working with and you felt like it was deja vu over again because there were not, guys weren't in the critical mass, but some of the same issues occurred. There can be, in the tech field, an element of mean girls culture, which is the female version of bro culture. But we are our sisters and our brothers' keeper. And to live up to our full destiny, we must empower women. This is not just about my career or your individual career path, although that is very, very important. If we're not promoting justice and equity for all, we will have failed. Women's leadership matters. There's an old African proverb that says, educate a woman and you change a nation. Empower a woman and you empower a business. Empower a woman and you empower a country. Empower a woman, and all of the research shows this now. We're in a new era. It is our time. It's called womanomics in Japan. It's called the feminine dividend and a lot of the UN research. But we cannot have, it's recognized for the first time in history, that we cannot sustain our economies and our land unless women are included as equals in our leadership. Tech women save the planet. And we're not in it just because tech is good or it's cool. We're in this because tech can work for good. Tech can work for all humanity. I started us off by saying that I was on a walkabout in Australia for the past 2.5 weeks to contemplate how we could become the change. The answer is, you are the change. What you have done the past 2 days is joined a movement. And I want to end with one of my greatest inspirations, Margaret Mead. And she said in the 1950s, and it's still true today, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed people can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that has ever done that. Thank you so much for being here. Stay in touch. We are here.
Thank you, Jackie. So I think that's a fantastic ambition that we all should be aiming to create a 50-50 by 2025 action plan that details everything that we, at an individual level, the actions that we can take to try and make that happen. I mentioned that we owe a debt of gratitude to the AnitaB.org team, represented by all of the fabulous members of the AnitaB.org team here today. Thank you. The other people who made this event happen are our Foundation Hopper Down Under sponsors. And I bet you know them off by heart now. Starts with A. ANU, the Australian National University. Thank you. Starts with B. BHP. Thank you. Oh, we've got ABC, who starts with C. Oh, it's a harder one. CSIRO's Data 61. Thank you. And we have Google. Thank you. Microsoft. Monash University. You all must be split up. I'm not hearing the energy. Northrop Grumman. QUT. Oh. Oh, now this should get a big roar. The University of Adelaide. And the University of Melbourne. So has everyone had a great conference? Well, that's great, because I hope you remember these days, because you are here at the start of something special. As Jackie said, this is the launch of our very own AnitaB.org community. And when you look back at these days, you can all be justifiably proud to have been a part of this significant event. The point I was trying to make is that we really should be proud of our foundation sponsors, because they're the catalysts who have made this possible. And we do need catalysts to turn the tide towards more diversity and inclusion in our region, especially in the tech industry. And that means that we need more companies like our foundation sponsors to support these aims and to support women technologists in our region, precisely so that we can all be here together. We are here because of our foundation sponsors. And here representing one of our foundation sponsors, ANU, is Professor Steve Blackburn, Associate Dean for Diversity and Inclusion in the College of Engineering and Computer Science. Steve has been at ANU since he did his PhD in the mid-90s, and his close collaborator for 20 years has been Catherine McKinley, a champion and pioneer of women in computer science, first as a professor at the University of Texas and now as a researcher at Google. Catherine has had many years of involvement with Hopper and has been on the board of the Computing Research Association for Women, the CRAW, for many years, and indeed is the past chair of the CRAW. Please welcome Professor Steve Blackburn.
Well, this is just marvelous. It's just a great privilege to be here in this room and all these women in front of me, because I'm used to speaking in conferences and so forth, and I just don't see this, and it's just I'm thrilled. It's often said that to the privileged, equality feels like oppression. And I've certainly seen that among some of my privileged peers. But I just want to say, however, that my own experience has been quite the opposite. If equality means diversity, then my experience of diversity amongst my students and my collaborators has actually been one of that's brought me a great deal of joy. It's been an immense privilege to work with a diverse group of wonderful students, a number of whom are in the room. I can't see you because of the spotlights, but some of you are right here right now, and it's just been such a great privilege to work with you. Amazing women who are a constant source of pride to me. It's also been an immense privilege to work with colleagues like Genevieve and Eleanor, who are visionary and energetic and are out there to really change things for all of us, including everyone in this room. I've also been privileged, as you just heard, to have as my principal collaborator and mentor for the past 20 years, Catherine McKinley, not only an exceptional computer scientist, but a persistent and prominent leader in the campaign for women in computer science. And she's taken on many roles, as you just heard. The impact amazing women like this have had on people like me can't be underestimated. It's been extraordinary. It's been a key part of my entire career, and it's really changed the way I've seen the world as a computer scientist. Above all, it was my great privilege to marry a scientist. For 27 years, I've watched my wife traverse a long and winding path as a senior scientist at a top university. Seeing her successes and her impact has been a constant source of joy and pride to me. However, I have to say that it's also been a path that's not always been pleasant, and there have been times that have made me really sad, and occasionally times that have filled me with rage. This brings me to one of our opening addresses from Jackie, and she asked all of us to ask ourselves the question, what will I do? Now, I invite everyone in the room to pause just for a moment and ask themselves that question. What will I do? What will we do? I'm painfully aware of how much I've got to do. I'm looking at you, Dean. I'm honoured to be working with a dean who set us at ANU some remarkable goals, and with a vice chancellor who's holding us to those goals. By 2030, we will not only have gender parity amongst our undergraduate population, but amongst our academics in engineering and computer science. And that's an incredibly audacious goal. I know from my own perspective and from what I just told you a few moments ago, how much this positive transformation will affect me, my colleagues, and all the students who come through our institution in the years that come. Finally, I want to end up with thanks to those who made this possible. In particular, I want to thank all of the sponsors, our amazing speakers, all of the volunteers, the AnitaB.org, and above all, those who had the vision to make this possible. So let's give them another round of thanks. Last of all, I want to thank each one of you for being here and for being part of what is a wonderful celebration of women in technology down under. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Steve, and thank you, ANU. Hopper Down Under, as you've heard a few times already, would not have been possible without the support of a range of people, not only our sponsors, but also our presenters, the people who volunteered their time to review submissions, our session chairs, and the wonderful staff at MCI and the Brisbane Convention and Exhibition Centre. For making this wonderful event happen this week, I'm going to make a few people stand up once again. I'd like you to join me in thanking my fellow local steering committee members, Sally Ann Williams, Annabelle Cooper, Jane Scowcroft, Kat Faulkner, and really, without the unwavering support of the AnitaB.org team, this event would not have been possible. So please, everybody on the AnitaB.org team, stand up so we can all see you. And I'd also like to ask all of our volunteers to stand up. Our hoppers, who you can recognise because they're all wearing one of these shirts, stand. Our volunteer reviewers and session chairs, you know who you are, I know who you are, please stand up. Thank you. So, a lot of people have helped make this event a reality, as you could see. Thank you all, because we are here because of you. And finally, a big thank you to everyone who has supported Hopper Down Under by presenting and attending this conference over the last 2 days. You, everyone in this room, are the true believers. You joined us because you know this is important, and you are why we are here. And as you've heard, this is not the end. This is just the beginning. We now have an AnitaB.org community for Australia and New Zealand. And as you would have heard, and I hope you've got it in your diaries already, in September we will be holding Hopper events in Brisbane, Adelaide, Sydney, Melbourne, and I've just found out, Canberra. Now, where are our New Zealand cousins? Right, please come and see me. We need to make something happen in New Zealand as well. We can do it. So this week we've ignited a flame, and it's now up to you, everyone in this room, to keep that flame alive. Remember that change does not happen through inaction. It is within the power of every one of you here today to contribute to positive change, to help us achieve the vision of AnitaB.org and finally see a future where the people who imagine and build technology mirror the people and societies for which they build it. This is the start. We are here. And we now need to take action. So to all of you, you true believers, let's keep the dream alive. Safe travels home, and good night.